Topic 4.5, feedback and homeostasis. What is homeostasis? What are feedback mechanisms and how do they connect to homeostasis? How can antagonistic negative feedback loops be paired to promote homeostasis? So let's explain how insulin and glucagon maintain blood glucose homeostasis. What about positive feedback loops? How does positive feedback work? Explain how positive feedback works during childbirth. I'm Mr. W from learn-biology.com, where we believe that interaction and feedback is what leads to deep, substantial learning. We're so sure of that, that we provide a money-back guarantee that comes with your subscription. What is homeostasis? What are feedback mechanisms and how do they connect to homeostasis? Homeostasis is the tendency of a living system to maintain its internal conditions at a relatively constant, optimal level. Your body temperature, for example, stays around 37 degrees Celsius, 98.6 Fahrenheit, despite fluctuations in the external temperature. The changes in your body to maintain that temperature, that's a great example of homeostasis. Feedback is when the output of a system is also an input. So here we have some system, here's the thing that's coming out, and feedback is when it feeds back into the system. So the output is also an input. And feedback can do two things. One is connected to homeostasis. It can allow organisms to maintain homeostasis as they respond to internal and external changes, just as I told you with temperature, or it can accelerate internal changes and drive a process towards a conclusion. This is generally connected with what's called negative feedback, and this is connected with what's called positive feedback. Let's talk about set points. What is a set point? How are set points used in negative feedback? First, a word about the method here. We're going to talk about this in relationship to your home heating and cooling system. It's much easier to understand this before we look at the biological examples. So a set point is where you set the thermostat. It's the value around which a homeostatic process fluctuates. So above, the set point for the thermostat is 68 degrees Fahrenheit. In negative feedback, the output of the system feeds back to the system in a way that decreases the system's output. So here we have the set point. Here's a measurement of the temperature. The set point is above the temperature. That'll send a signal to turn on the furnace. That'll generate heat. Heat feeds back to the system. There's a thermostat over here with a thermometer that will increase the temperature. And then when we get to 68 degrees Fahrenheit, the set point, the system will turn off. Negative feedback promotes homeostasis, returning a system to its set point. How can antagonistic negative feedback loops be paired to promote homeostasis? So, same goal. Keep the temperature at 68 degrees. Well, here we have a negative feedback system that responds when conditions are above the set point. So, temperature 70, the set point is 68, what will you do? You'll have a signal that turns on an air conditioner. That will put out cool, it's a real word, and that will feed back to the system and eventually it'll get the system to turn itself off. There's been cooling and we've therefore lowered the temperature. But we still have a heating system. And if the temperature goes below the set point, then that system would turn on, it would release heat, that would feed back to the system, and that would wind up turning the system off. So we have paired antagonistic systems, one for cooling, one for heating. Now we're going to look at some biology. Is AP Bio making you feel overwhelmed and inadequate? That's completely reasonable. At learn-biology.com, we understand why students struggle with AP Bio. The material is complex, the pace is brutal, and the vocabulary is ridiculous. But at learn-biology.com, we've created a way that makes it easier for you to study. Go to learn-biology.com, sign up for a free trial, and complete our interactive tutorials and interactive AP Bio exam reviews. We guarantee you a 4 or 5 on the AP Bio exam. See you on learn-biology.com. Let's talk about how feedback works in blood sugar homeostasis. It's important to your body to maintain your blood sugar levels, your blood glucose levels. The main hormone that controls that is insulin, and it's a negative feedback system. In response to high blood glucose levels after eating a sugary or a starchy meal, your pancreas will release the hormone insulin, just represented here as a triangle. In the liver, insulin will bind at a receptor over here, and that will unleash a signaling cascade, and that talks to a glucose transporter. That's a channel that allows for facilitated diffusion. If glucose is in higher concentration outside than inside the cell, it'll diffuse into liver cells, and the glucose will get converted into glycogen, which is a storage polysaccharide, or it'll get converted into fat. Blood glucose levels down, homeostasis restored. But as with our home heating and cooling system, insulin is paired with another hormone. So let's explain how insulin and glucagon maintain blood glucose homeostasis. Our blood glucose has a set point, about 90 milligrams per deciliter. Above the set point, the pancreas will release insulin. Eat a big meal, insulin gets released, and your liver, fat, and muscle cells, which aren't shown, will absorb glucose and store it away as glycogen. Below the set point, that's when you've gone a little while without eating, what'll happen is that the pancreas will release a second hormone called glucagon, and that will induce the liver to convert its stores of glycogen into glucose. Glucose goes into the blood, homeostasis is restored. An important AP Bio skill is explaining what happens when systems get disrupted. And here we're going to explain how blood glucose homeostasis breaks down in type 2 diabetes. That's also called adult onset diabetes, but increasingly it's happening in teens and even children due to the obesity epidemic in the United States. We're going to look at normal metabolism first, which we just discussed. Here we see insulin, in response to a high blood glucose level, is binding with the insulin receptor. There's a signaling cascade that causes the glucose channel to open. There's glucose absorption into the cells. Blood glucose level falls. Homeostasis restored. In people with type 2 diabetes, what happens is that the cells become insulin resistant. There's glucose in the blood. There's insulin released from the pancreas, but the binding of insulin does not lead to the signaling cascade. And because of that, the glucose channel remains closed. Because of that, blood glucose level stays high, and that damages organs and tissues. Breakdown of homeostasis leading to type 2 diabetes. We just discussed adult onset type 2 diabetes. How does that compare with type 1 diabetes? Type 1 is also known as juvenile diabetes. It's an autoimmune disorder, and basically what happens is that cells of your immune system attack the pancreas cells that produce insulin. Therefore, those cells can no longer secrete insulin, and therefore, even in response to a high blood glucose level, insulin is not secreted. That can only be treated by insulin injections. Type 2 diabetes, we've just discussed, also called adult onset, and that involves insulin resistance where the receptor has become insensitive to the insulin signal. All of the biological feedback loops that we've talked about so far relating to blood sugar have involved negative feedback loops. What about positive feedback loops? How does positive feedback work? Explain how positive feedback works during childbirth. So in positive feedback, the output of a system feeds back into the system, increasing the system's activity and output. It doesn't involve quieting that leads to homeostasis, it involves acceleration. It drives a biological process such as childbirth to a conclusion, after which the system shuts down. In childbirth, the growth of a baby activates uterine stretch receptors. The uterus, among other things, is a big muscle. When that muscle is stretched out, it sends messages to the brain. The brain releases oxytocin, a hormone. That oxytocin then circulates in the blood. When it's picked up by receptors in uterine cells, that leads to more contraction. That increased contraction leads to more oxytocin release, and ultimately that continues until the baby is born. Explain how feedback leads to fruit ripening. If you were to pause the video and take a look at this diagram, I'll bet you that you could figure it out. This is a positive feedback system. Ripening in fruit leads to the release of a hormone that is a gas. It's called ethylene. Ethylene receptors in nearby fruit pick up the ethylene, and that induces additional ripening and more ethylene production. That increased concentration of ethylene accelerates the ripening process in all the fruit, leading to more ethylene. So eventually all the fruit ripens. In fruit shipping, you can prevent that by pumping carbon dioxide into the storage container where the fruit are, and that suppresses the ethylene, and that's how you can ship fruit long distances. Want to learn more? Sign up for a free trial of the website that guarantees your AP Biology success. Learn-biology.com and watch this next video.